special be there for me? Yeah. Will you walk with me down on the street? Talk to me, tell me what you see. Stand by me so the world will see.
So the world will see you and me in you. worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one. Thank you.
Thank you, team. Well, have a seat. Welcome, each one of you. It's great to have you with us this morning. Very chilly morning, so a warm welcome to you, and a special warm welcome if you're visiting. And of all the mornings that you need a warm welcome today, many parts of South Australia were minus, so hopefully our fellowship can continue to warm our hearts as well. Well, my name is Mal, and it's a blessing to be here together this morning. We've got a very special morning for the children coming up very shortly. And let us just commit our time to the Lord in prayer. Dear Father, we are indeed thankful. We're so thankful for your grace and for your love. We're thankful for each other and the fellowship we can enjoy in your spirit. This morning, we are going to hear from your word something quite challenging. And I pray, Lord, that your spirit would cut through our minds to our hearts, that we can absorb what you want us to hear this morning. And we thank you for the fun we can have right now with the children as well. We pray, Lord, that you would bless these little ones and bless this service. May our praise be worthy. In Jesus' name, amen. So children, we have a special guest. Her name is Violet, and she'd like to come and share something with you now. So please come forward, children. Don't be shy. If you need mum and dad to come with you or grandma and grandpa, that's fine. But come down. There's a spot for you right at the front here. And we don't mind if you rush. You can jog down, make it quick.
Good morning, kids.
Good morning, whatever your name is.
Good morning, Violet.
Good morning.
Violet, are you okay? You don't seem your cheerful self this morning.
No, I'm fine.
Are you sure? Is something the matter?
Well, if you were really asking me, no, I'm not doing fine.
What's happened, Violet?
I don't know if I want to tell you.
Well, Violet, you can tell me, and I want you to know that you can trust me, and I'll help you the best that I can.
Well, last week in Sunday school, do you remember how we were running around in the classroom playing dodgeball?
Yeah.
And remember you told us to stop because we might break things and we just stop throwing around things?
Yeah.
Well, when you left the room to go grab something, I was playing dodgeball with my friend, and I missed my friend, and I accidentally hit something, and I broke something.
Okay, what did you hit?
Promise you won't be mad.
It's okay, Violet, I won't be mad.
Well, I accidentally hit the TV, and I smashed it, and it's all broken, and when you were coming back, I saw my mom, so I quickly ran to her so you wouldn't see me.
Violet, it's okay. I'm glad that you decided to tell me. That must have been very hard for you to do.
Wait, you're not mad?
Well, naturally, I'm a bit upset. The TV was very expensive. But no, I'm not mad at you. I'm actually happy that you decided to tell me.
Well, that's not all.
It's not?
Well, my mom must have heard about it because she came home and asked if we knew what happened.
Yeah, that's right. I asked all the parents if any of the kids knew what had happened.
And when she asked me if I knew anything about it, I told her I didn't know anything about it.
Violet, calm down. It's okay. I forgive you.
You do?
Yes, I forgive you.
Oh, but the TV, it's all smashed up and it's very, very expensive. I have to spend all my pocket money for the next 100 years to pay it back.
Well, Violet, I have something I need to tell you.
It's more than 100 years?
Well, no, but I actually know it was you who broke the TV.
You do, but you weren't there. How did you know?
Well, on my way back to the classroom, I saw through the window and I saw you throw the ball.
Oh no, but why you didn't say anything?
Well, you ran straight past me and then you left, so I wanted to give you the opportunity to tell me yourself.
Sorry, I was scared. I didn't know what to do. And I was afraid to be in trouble.
Like I said, Violet, it's okay. I forgive you.
But how can you forgive me? I don't deserve to be forgiven.
Well, Violet, God actually sets us an amazing example of forgiveness of sin in the Bible. You see, firstly, God actually sees everything we do, even when we do the wrong thing. Just like I saw you break that TV after I'd asked you not to play dodgeball inside. And even though we do the wrong thing, we can't hide it from God, no matter how hard we try. Do you remember who else in the Bible tried to hide their sin from God?
Nope.
No. Adam and Eve, they disobeyed God, and they tried to hide from him, but God knew they had sinned. The same with Jonah, he disobeyed God and ran away.
Oh yeah, I remember, I learned that in class.
That's right. And you know what? When we sin and we try and hide it from God, it usually leads to more sin.
Mm-hmm. Yes, yes, because I didn't want my mom to know, so I lied to her too.
That's right. But the best news of all is even though God sees everything and knows everything, he still loves us despite our sin. The Bible says in 1 John 1:9, but God is faithful and fair. If we confess our sins, he will forgive our sins. He will forgive every wrong thing we have ever done. He will make us pure.
Wow. Wow, God must love us so much that he will forgive us after all the bad things we've done.
Yes, he does. All we have to do is ask him. But that's not all.
It's not?
No. You see, even though you broke that TV, and even though it costs a lot of money, you don't need to pay for it.
What?
Yep, I actually already bought a brand new TV and replaced the old one.
But it's so expensive. How can you pay it with your ministry wage?
Yes, it was very expensive, but I wanted to pay the price on your behalf.
But that's far too kind of you.
Well, it's exactly what God has done for us. You see, when we sin, there is a punishment. And even though we are forgiven, the penalty for our sin still needs to be paid.
So it's kind of like I broke the TV and saying sorry doesn't mean it will be fixed and it still needs to be paid for?
That's right. You see, the Bible says that punishment for disobeying God is that we'll be separated from him forever.
Forever? You mean ever, ever?
Yeah, but the good news is we don't have to be.
Wow. Is it because of Jesus?
Yes, because Jesus came to earth and lived a perfect life. He did nothing wrong. He never sinned.
Wow, that must be so hard to have never done anything wrong.
Well, actually, it wasn't hard for Jesus because he was God. So he never did anything wrong. He died and took the punishment that we deserved so we wouldn't have to.
Kind of like I broke the TV and you paid for it and I didn't have to?
Yes, exactly. And Jesus didn't even stay dead. He rose again, back to life, and defeated death.
Wow, how cool. Hey, I remember I learned that in Easter.
Yeah, that's right, you did. So what do you think you've learned from all of this today, Violet?
Well, firstly, I should listen to adults and obey them, and when they tell me to do things that I should listen to them.
Yeah, that's right.
And when I do the wrong things, I shouldn't hide or lie about it because God knows.
He does.
And if I hurt someone, I should also apologize to them, right?
Right.
And no matter how hard it is, I should confess to God when I have done something wrong because Jesus, God, he will forgive me.
Yep, that's how incredible God's love for us is. He forgives us every time and even takes away the punishment we deserve. Wow, Violet, sure sounds like you've learned a lot.
Well, I'm really sorry, Nancy. I should have listened to you.
It's okay, Violet, I forgive you.
Nancy?
Yes?
Can we pray now?
Of course we can. Would you like to pray?
Yes, please.
Okay, why don't we all bow our heads and pray together?
Dear God, I'm so sorry I disobeyed Nancy and I disobeyed you. I'm so sorry that I tried to hide my sin from you and lie about it to my mom. Please forgive me for all my sins. Thank you that you love me so much even when I do wrong things. Thank you that you sent your son Jesus to die on the cross to take away the punishment we deserve for disobeying you. Thank you that you are my best friend. Amen.
Amen.
Thanks, Nancy. I actually feel so much better now.
Yeah, I bet you do. We can bring all of our problems to God, and he says that he can take our worries away from us.
Thank you. Thank you so much for helping me to confess to God.
You're welcome, Violet. Can you please try not break any more TVs?
Okay.
Hi, and welcome to CityReach. My name is Lauren, and I serve on the Pathways Playgroup Leadership Team, as well as Pebbles Creche here at CityReach Oakden. If this is your first time here, hopefully you will have received a welcome bag on your way in. If not, please feel free to grab one in the foyer after the service. Inside the bag, you'll find a voucher for a free coffee served by one of our friendly baristas in the terrace. And you'll also find one of these Next Steps cards inside. Please fill this out and hand it in at the welcome table in the foyer so we can get in touch with you. Now let's check out what's happening here at CityReach. CityReach Kids is presenting a family movie night this Saturday, the 16th of July at 5 p.m. We'll be watching Toy Story 4. Tickets are $5 per person, and that includes pizza, popcorn, soft drinks, and hot drinks. This event is free for children 0 to 2, and feel free to bring your beanbags, blankets, pillows, etc. To book your tickets, scan the QR code on screen or grab a flyer from the foyer today. Registrations close this Thursday. Found Young Adults and Fuse Independent Adults are combining for a Christmas in July party on Friday, 22nd of July, 6:30 p.m. Please wear your ugly Christmas sweaters, bring along a Kris Kringle re-gift. The first 30 people to register will go in a raffle to win a Christmas surprise. Register on our website today. On Sunday, 24th of July, we will be hosting Mark Emerson from Creation Ministries, who will be teaching on why we can be sure that our loving God truly spoke this world into existence and what this means for our lives. Invite your friends and don't miss it. Are you new to CityReach? We would love to invite you to our welcome lunch, which will be held on Sunday, 7th of August at 12:30 p.m. in the cafe. Come and meet some of the staff, hear about our ministry here at CityReach Oakden. To register, please leave your name at the welcome table in the foyer or call the office this week. We hope to see you there. It is such a blessing to be part of a church community who gives so that we can reach people here and abroad with the good news. You're welcome to give online, or if you've come prepared today, you can give at the information desk in the foyer. May the love of Christ reach those who need him through the offerings that we bring. As always, it is such a privilege to gather together as God's people this morning. Please stick around after the service for a coffee in the terrace and a chat.
Our Bible reading this morning comes from Psalm 51. And I hope, sincerely hope, that Violet is available to do next week's church news. Psalm 51, it will be on the screen, or you can follow it in your own Bible or phone. And the backdrop to Psalm 51 is a very serious story of very unique circumstances with a great result of grace. It is written by David, and something very personal that happened to him. So Psalm 51, let's read together, shall we? Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love, according to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgression, and my sin is ever before me. Against you, you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight. so that you may be justified in your words and blameless in your judgment. Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. Behold, you delight in truth, in the inward being, and you teach me wisdom in the secret heart. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones that you have broken rejoice. Hide your face from my sins and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and uphold me with a willing spirit. Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners will return to you. Deliver me from blood guiltiness, O God, the God of my salvation, and my tongue will sing aloud your righteousness. O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth will declare your praise, for you will not delight in sacrifice, or I would give it. You will not be pleased with a burnt offering. The sacrifices of God are a broken and contrite heart. O God, you will not despise these. Do good to Zion in your good pleasure. Build up the walls of Jerusalem. Then you will delight in right sacrifices, in burnt offerings and whole offerings. Then bulls will be offered upon your altar. Let's stand together and we will sing again. Thank you.
All my life you have been so, so good. Just take a seat, if you like. Well, good morning. My name's Tony. I'm the youth director here at CityReach. I'm preaching on late notice. Not too late, but late enough. And we're going to be doing, we're having a break from our normal series in Simon Peter, The Reed and the Rock, and we're, for these holidays, we're just going to look at this series called Growing in Grace. Growing in Grace. And your first lesson in the school of growing in grace is hearing me preach. So hopefully it goes all right. As Jeremy and Josh said at church camp, enthusiasm high, expectations low. All right. It's usually what happens in the holidays when our pastors are on leave with their families. But we've got to ask the question as we introduce the little series we're going to do is, why do we need to grow in grace? Why do we even need to grow in grace? And I think it's a common misconception that the gospel of grace is only relevant to our salvation. We think about Ephesians chapter 2, is by grace we are saved through faith. And we see grace as this redeeming power of God, that he just shine his face upon us and give us his grace. But we only think about it as if it's the door that enters into Christianity, enters into, grace is this door that we walk through. But it's not just the door, it's the whole building. Grace, the gospel of grace is the whole building by which we sit under, during our whole Christian lives, through our whole walk. And as we grow in our relationship with Jesus, as we walk with him and follow him, we need to be growing in our self-awareness of who we are and who he is. We need to be becoming more and more aware of how broken we are. We need to be becoming more and more aware of how wonderful he is and how beautiful he is and how much we need him and how much we need his grace. But not just grace in the aspect of our relationship with God, but also grace with one another. We need to be growing in grace together. And this morning, we're going to be looking at the grace of confession. Grace of confession. Mal read out for us Psalm 51, and I really urge you to follow along with in God's word with me. That way, all the pressure's off me, and God can speak to you through his word. I wonder, though, if we're meant to be growing in grace and growing in our relationship with God every day, do you find verse 3 a little too relatable, as we read it this morning? For I know my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. How can we be growing in grace when we feel as though sin is just always there? It's ever before me. Or as verse 5 says, in sin did my mother conceive me. Isaiah says in Isaiah 6, when he's in the presence of God, he says, woe is me, I'm undone. I'm a man of unclean lips that dwells among people of unclean lips. How are we meant to grow in grace when we're surrounded by sin in our own life, but also surrounded by sin in this whole world? And the context to Psalm 51, which Mal alluded to already, is a very serious story. It comes from 2 Samuel chapter 11 and 12. And David, King David is the most powerful man in the world at the time. Israel is at the height of its power, and God has blessed David immensely. He's blessed him spiritually. He's promised that his kingdom would be an everlasting kingdom. The Messiah would come through David. But just on a secular level, just in this physical realm, God had blessed him immensely. He'd given him so much. And David should have been off at war with his army, but instead he decided to stay home in Jerusalem during the war season. He saw Bathsheba bathing on the rooftop near his palace, and he commanded that Bathsheba come and spend the night with him. We don't talk too much about the fact that that would have been against Bathsheba's will. What David said went because he was the king. Bathsheba fell pregnant because of this, and David tried to cover up his sin even further by getting Uriah, trying to trick Uriah, Bathsheba's wife, to come home and sleep with her. Didn't work out, so then David orchestrated the murder of Uriah, and then he could take Bathsheba as his own wife. He's already had a few wives by now as well. Now, chapter 12 is Nathan the prophet coming to David and telling him this parable of this rich man who had thousands of sheep, and he wanted to throw a banquet for a visiting friend. So instead of taking one of his thousands of sheep, the rich man took this poor man's one lamb whom he loved and had that one slaughtered for the banquet. And David was furious by the story, and he commanded that, let me know who this man is so we can bring him to justice. And Nathan the prophet said those damning words to David, you are the man. Now, and as a result, we have Psalm 51. This is how David responded to that confrontation of his sin. And one of my pet peeves when we talk about characters in the Bible is we try to make ourselves feel better. David was a man after God's own heart, and yet look at the mistakes he made. Isn't it wonderful that God can use someone like David despite all of his flaws and all his mistakes? Now, one, that's annoying because this wasn't just a mistake. This wasn't an oopsie-daisy. This was a serious, heinous sin. And much like the kids talk this morning, he tried to cover it up. But not just that, contrary to what was the norm back then, David in his position didn't have to have this attitude. He could have continued to cover it up. Normally, he would have just had Nathan put to death for confronting him. But the thing that makes David a man after God's own heart is that he has a humble heart. He has a humble and a contrite heart. And he is willing to face up to his sin rather than cover it up further. And so this morning, what I'm going to do is I'm just going to walk through in no particular order of Psalm 51. And I'm going to ask some questions. And if we have a heart like David, a humble and contrite one, these questions are going to be very challenging. And so I just ask you to have, like David, an open heart and open mind, and let God speak to you as you try to answer these questions. The first question I'd ask is, do you know your sin? Do you know your sin? For I know my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Do you know your sin, or are you blinded to your sin? Do you not see it for what it is? Because if we're growing in grace, we should be becoming more and more aware of our sin and our brokenness, more and more aware of our need of grace. And quite often, what stops us from seeing our sin is our pride. Is pride blocking your awareness of your sin? Because if we're growing in grace, we should be becoming more and more humble and less proud. So if we're struggling to see our sin, I think it's stunting our growth in grace. How can we know if pride has blinded us to our sin? Well, when you're confronted with it, the first thing you'll do is justify it. Now, you might try and justify it through different means. You might be quick to point it out in other people, pass the blame to other people. Quite often what you might do is pass the blame to certain circumstances in your life. Or what's the normal way of behaving in this world? But David doesn't do that. We have to understand, this is a jarring story to hear what David did 3,000 years later. But 3,000 years ago, what David did was perfectly culturally acceptable in his time. The king of a nation could do whatever he wanted. He could take whatever woman he wanted, and he could orchestrate the death of anybody. But when confronted with his sin, David didn't get angry at Nathan. He didn't try to hide it or cover it up or see what was, explain it away by what was culturally acceptable. He stood up to his sin and he confessed it. And what we often do when we're confronted with our sin is we try to justify it and explain it away. It's culturally acceptable. Everybody's doing this. One of the most common things that I see is when someone's not even confronted or just something in their life is brought to the surface where they've an indiscrepancy, a failure in their life, the first thing they'll do is they'll say, I've just been really tired. I've just been really stressed. And somehow or other, that justifies flying off the handle at people and getting angry. Since when is it okay to treat other people like dirt because you're tired or because your circumstances are stressful? Since when is it okay to give in to sexual temptation because you're just feeling a bit stressed? David doesn't do that. He's not blinded by his sin. And so I'd ask you again, do you know your sin? Do you know your sin? Next question that I'd ask is, do you know who you've sinned against? Do you know who you've sinned against? Against you, you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight. Now, this does not exclude what David has done to Bathsheba and to Uriah's family. He's done a terrible thing to them. I'm sure that he dealt with it. But he's conversing with God and he's talking to God and he's acknowledging that ultimately he sinned against God. Tim Keller, I feel like, sums this up really well in one of his devotionals. Lord, when I sin against others and even myself, I'm ultimately sinning against you, because we are all made for your possessions, whom you love. When I sin, I don't just break your laws, but trample on your heart. Help me to grasp that, because it helps me not just to admit my sins, but forsake them. Sinning against others and sinning against yourself is sinning against a holy God, as we were created in his image. And I don't think the church, let alone the world, truly acknowledges the seriousness of sin and see it for how disgusting it really is in the eyes of a holy God. It is an unholy act towards a holy God who is perfect. And that is why, because of his perfection, because of his holiness, verse 4, he says, you are justified in your words and blameless in your judgment. He has the right to judge us. He can judge us because he is perfect and we are not. In verse 9, it says, hide your face from my sins. God can't look at sin. He can't look, and a holy God can't look at unholiness. Verse 11 says, cast me not away from your presence and take not your Holy Spirit from me. God has every right to cast out sin. If he sees it, he can't look at it. He has every right to cast it out and not be in its presence. And this doesn't gel very well with our generation. I don't know who made this quote 100%, but I like it. The gospel sounds very strange to a generation that has been told they are perfect, loving themselves is virtuous, their heart is always right, their mistakes are someone or something else's fault, and nothing is more important than being happy. It's a very jarring thing to hear that a holy God is not happy with our sin. And we need to acknowledge who we have sinned against. Like Nathan does with David, he compares it to grabbing something, taking something that is not your own. Sinning against God is like a rich man with thousands of sheep taking a poor man's beloved lamb. The book of Hosea, it struck me afresh this week that God compares his relationship with Israel, their constant idolatry, their constant sin against him, that it was like being married to a prostitute. That he's redeemed them out of that lifestyle, he's redeemed them and saved them, but yet they still turn away from him, they still keep going back to their sin. And how much that breaks God's heart. And when we understand, when we grow in grace and we become more aware of who God is, how holy he is, how wonderful he is, we realize then who we've sinned against. And as we become more aware of his holiness, we become more aware of our brokenness, and our sin becomes so much more evident. The next question in this part I'd ask you is, do you know what needs to happen? In verse 10, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Do you know why you sin? We've already talked about circumstances, and circumstances, don't hear me wrong, they do add to the context. They do make things harder, yes. But we can't blame our sin on the circumstances or on other people or justify it. But there is a reason that we have sinned, and it's not just the circumstances. See, the heart of the issue is the heart. And we need to come to God and we need to confess specific sin in our life, yes. But what true repentance is not saying, I repent of this sin and I'm not going to do it anymore. The sin isn't actually the problem. The problem is the sinner. So God doesn't just need to deal with the sin, he needs to deal with the sinner. And that's why the language of Psalm 51, David says things like, cleanse me, purge me with hyssop, wash me, and I'll be white as snow. Again, that doesn't feel nice, does it? Especially when you've been told you're perfect, especially when you've been told you're pretty good, or deep down you think you're all right. To know that the problem is actually our heart, that's what actually needs cleansing and purifying, is a hard thing to grasp. God just doesn't want to deal with the sin. He wants to deal with the sinner. He wants to deal with the heart of the issue. Now, one question you might have is, how is confession grace? How is confession grace? Because we think about the word grace, and that's a warm feeling word, isn't it? We think about it in relation to salvation. God just giving us what we don't deserve. What a nice thing. But then the word confession, that's a dirty word. That makes us feel vulnerable. How is grace confession? Well, if you ever reach a point where you've confessed something, you want to confess something before a holy God, that's not on you. We have this danger of thinking, treating confession like religion and actually giving ourselves a pat on the back, like, look at me go. I'm confessing my sin like a good Christian. But because of our brokenness, as we grow in grace, we become more aware of this. Because of our brokenness, we are incapable of reaching out to a holy God. The only way that you can reach out to a holy God is by Him working in your life. He gave you the grace and the mercy to do that. And so when you reach a point of confession, when you call out for His grace, you've actually already got it. Because in our brokenness, we are incapable of calling out for God's grace. God's grace is upon you when you come to this point of confession. Now, what do I need to confess? What do we need to confess? Now, we shouldn't be ignorant or naive that just because we're in a church that there aren't some heinous sins being committed. Like, we're all broken, right? I've said it so many times this morning. We're all broken. We're all susceptible to sin. And don't see it as an accident that you're in this room this morning in your chair, and it just so happens that we're looking at Psalm 51, talking about confession. And the context to Psalm 51 is very serious. Let's not kid ourselves that some of us in the room this morning, there might be a various sin to confess. There may be a habitual sin that needs to be confessed. And don't take God's timing and his grace and mercy in your life to bring you to this position, the timing that we're looking at this passage, don't take that lightly. He wants you to confess something maybe. But for many of us, the temptation is to be like, well, I'm not an adulterous murderer, so this isn't for me. I've got nothing to confess. Everything's pretty hunky-dory at the moment. But if that's, I challenge you, that if that's the first place, if that's what you're saying, then I'd challenge you to go back and watch the video and listen to the first third of the sermon. But if that's the first place that our heart goes, that we're automatically like, well, this isn't for me. I'm not David. I haven't been giving in to sin. I've been pretty good. Other people have. that's the first place your mind and heart goes, then I challenge you that maybe what you need to confess is that you have a self-righteous religious heart. And that maybe you need to confess a Pharisaical attitude. That you've been going through the motions of church tradition and church religion. And what you need to confess before God is a heart that's not actually relying on Him, it's relying on your own works. And God doesn't care for empty, comfortable religion. As verse 16 says, "For you will not delight in sacrifice, or I will give it. You will not be pleased with a burnt offering." We need to confess if we have been relying on our own religious activity rather than God's saving grace. God doesn't care for empty, comfortable religion. He cares for your vulnerable heart of faith. Maybe you need to confess this morning that there's been pride blocking you from seeing your sin. Maybe you need to confess bitterness towards someone else. Maybe kids, we talk about the heart of the issue. You've been struggling with authority. You've been struggling with your parents and fighting and backchatting. Maybe you need to confess not just the sin, but what's behind it, in that your heart is saying, "I know best. I know better than my parents." Maybe you need to confess this morning that you're struggling. And in your pride and in your religion, you don't want to admit that you're struggling. You could confess this morning that, "God, I'm actually really struggling with doubt. I'm struggling with the purpose of everything." Maybe for a lot of you, there's nothing to confess. And that's awesome. But here's something that's applicable for all of us. We all need to confess who He is and who we are. It says in Philippians that one day everyone's going to do it anyway. Every knee will bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. But we think about confessing that Jesus Christ is Lord, and the first place our mind often goes is just salvation issue. Romans 10:9. If we confess with our mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord, we will be saved. We're thinking about it just as the door, but it's a building. We don't just confess it once and never again. We need to keep doing it. We need to keep confessing who He is, how wonderful He is, how beautiful He is, how powerful He is. And as we ponder that anew and confess that with our mouth, as we sing praises to Him and read His word, as we ponder how wonderful He is, we start to realize, wow, I'm actually really broken, aren't I? So we start to confess how broken we are and how much we need Him. And this is how we grow in grace. This is how we grow closer in our relationship with Him, by confessing who He is and who we are. We need to be confessing something. How do I know that we should be confessing something? One key symptom of the need to confess is that maybe your life has been a little bit joyless lately. That there's this weight on you, that something needs to be, this burden needs to be lifted on you. As verse 12 says, "Restore to me the joy of your salvation." Are you feeling the joy of God's salvation lately? Or have you been wrestling and struggling? Ray Ortland says this, "People living with unconfessed sin groan. They groan about this and they groan about that. But really, they're admitting that they have sin still unconfessed. Their strength is dried up. They are sluggish, unmotivated, always looking for ways to minimize their obedience because the joy is gone." Now, as you confess, we talk about the word confession. It's a vulnerable word. It sounds like a yucky word, but it's actually a freeing thing to do. It gives you freedom. And as you take what's happening in the recesses of your heart, that's happening in the darkness, and you drag it into the light, it has no power over you anymore. And it will free you and give you joy again. The joy of God's salvation will return to you. As Romans 6 says, "Consider yourselves dead to sin." You can't conquer a sin that you deny even exists. So we need to be more aware of our sin. We need to be more aware of who we sinned against. We need to be aware of what needs to happen. And when we confess this to the Lord, the joy will return. So I'd sum up this little part before I land the plane. What do you need to confess? My temptation is to try and lead you. Maybe you need to confess this or confess that, but this is between you and God. What's going on in your heart? What do you need to confess? Is it a sin? Is it a struggle? You just need to be confessing in humility more how wonderful He is. How do I confess? How do I confess? With our religious hearts, we quite often can treat this as a formula. If we say this, this, and this, you know, some of our other Christian brothers and sisters have fallen into this trap, treating confession as a religion. But confession is not about doing this, this, and this. It's about having a humble and a contrite heart. God doesn't care for your comfortable, empty religious activities. What He wants is a vulnerable heart of faith, a humble and a contrite heart. So confessing to God is not about coming to Him saying, "Dear God, this, this." It's coming to Him saying, "God, here it is, here I am, this is me." In humility, in contriteness, I'm confessing. And then as someone pointed out to me, something that I missed in the first service is, once our hearts are right, once our hearts are humble and contrite, then God cares about our sacrifices. Verse 19 says, "Then you will delight in right sacrifices in burnt offerings and whole burnt offerings. Then bulls will be offered on your altar." God cares about your heart first before any religious activity. The last question I'd ask is, do you know how much it cost? Do you know how much it cost? You might have noticed that I just completely missed verses 1 and 2. I started getting into the text. This is some of the most beautiful words in the psalm. "Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love, according to your abundant mercy. Blot out my transgression." You know, the reason that God can blot out our transgression, because He's a holy God, He had to deal with it. The reason that He can blot out our transgression, that He can cleanse us, is because Jesus paid the price on the cross. He took our unrighteousness, He took our transgressions, and He paid for that on the cross. It was mentioned so simply and beautifully with the kids this morning. And verse 9 says, "Hide your face from my sin." God the Father had to hide His face from Jesus the Son because He was bearing your sin and your transgression. So that is how a holy God can cleanse you and forgive you, because the price is paid. And 1 John 9:10 says, "If we confess our sin, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sin and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness." David is not calling on the mercy of a God who only has a little bit of mercy or not much. He's calling on a God, "Have mercy on me according to your steadfast love," a love that does not change, is not based on circumstances, unlike us. And He's not calling on a little bit of mercy, He's calling on abundant mercy, mercy that just keeps giving and giving and giving. And what sort of a God? Some of you might be thinking, because the confession, the whole topic is jarring, it's uncomfortable. Some of you might be thinking that God's trying to trick me if I confess to Him. And maybe that's from an experience that you've had in your own life. You're encouraged to confess and you're met with punishment about it. But God is not trying to encourage you or goad you into confession. And when you come to Him, He's waiting there with a 2x4, ready to beat you over the head. God is not a cruel, tyrannical God. When He invites you and encourages you to come to Him in confession, He is not waiting there with a 2x4. He is waiting there with open arms, ready to receive you. I mentioned before Hosea and how God compared the sin of Israel to being like married to a prostitute. It was such hard work for Him. It broke His heart. But God's attitude towards Israel was he yearned to take Israel back and to speak tenderly to them. Speak tenderly to her and woo her back. Not only is God a God who's welcoming us with open arms, he's also given us each other. James 5:16. Confess your sins one to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person has great power as it is working. I'll invite the band back up as I finish. And we've already talked about what do you need to confess and how you do it. And it's not about this, this, and this. But for some of you, you might be thinking, there's something in particular that I can't confess with this certain person. I can't confess to the whole church. And now, confession isn't about saying, dear Facebook, this is what's going on with me. Sometimes confession is between you and God, and that's a beautiful thing. But God has given us each other. He's given us each other. And so find someone you trust. Don't go home and don't forget it. If God has spoken to you, as I said, there's not an accident that we're talking about this passage, this topic this morning. There's a reason for it. Speak to someone that you trust. Let them pray for you. Let you be healed. Find victory over your sin and grow in grace. And if you're still scared about coming before this holy God, deep down you're thinking, how could he really love me? Let the words of this next song speak to you. This is the gospel. His love is immeasurable, powerful to save. Let me pray for you guys quickly. Dear Lord, I praise you that you're not a tyrant. You're not a cruel God. You desire our confession. You desire our humility. You desire a contrite heart. You will not despise that, Lord. That's what you want. And you don't want it because you're some egotistical God that wants what's best for you. You want what is best for us. I just praise you that you desire this confession, you desire this openness before you, but you also made it possible through the death of your Son. Lord, I praise you for your infinite wisdom, and I praise you that your love is just immeasurable. It's so vast, so incomprehensible, and that when we come to you, you're not waiting to beat us over the head. You're waiting with us, waiting for us with open arms. And I just ask that you'd speak to hearts, especially that are struggling this morning, that something's weighing on them, that you just give them the freedom to confess a heart attitude, a sin, whatever it may be. And Lord, if nothing else, let every heart in this room confess that you are Lord. Confess that you are mighty to save, that you are a beautiful, powerful, wonderful God, worthy of our worship. And let us confess that we need you. We need your grace and to keep growing in it. In your name I pray, amen. Let's stand and sing.
Beyond all measure.
if you don't have someone that you can trust, there might be someone that you trust, but it's just not appropriate for you to share something that's going on in your heart, there'll be people at the front here that can pray with you. Anyone on the worship team can pray with you. But I encourage you and challenge you, don't go home and just forget about the Holy Spirit working in your life. Strike while the iron's hot. Let Him do a work in you. Please come back next week. School holidays still. Bring your kids, and there'll be another kids talk from Josh Taylor. But otherwise, just want to bless you. Enjoy your holidays, those that are on holidays. And let me pray for us now. Dear Lord, just if nothing else this morning, just let us praise your name. We've got nothing to boast in other than yourself, your redeeming power to save. Lord, just want to worship you. And Lord, I just ask for each heart here this morning that we'd be pure before your eyes. Lord, I pray against any comfortable religion, the temptation to just go through the motions and to avoid being vulnerable, Lord. God, just give us a humble heart. Give this whole church a humble heart and guide us in the future dependent on you, dependent on you, our great and wonderful God. Bless us as we go and bless each one in their context, in their lives, and have your hand upon them and let your face shine upon us all. In your name I ask and thank you. Amen. Amen. God bless, guys.
That's kind of blurry. No, it's all good, don't worry. I get you on the line in a hurry. Ain't always there when I fall, but I know if I call that you gon' come through on time. Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. Always come through on time. You don't be there when I'm falling, but you gon' be there when I call. Whenever my life get confusing, and I don't be knowing at all. No lies so tight, you be stressing me. Still love how you bring out the best in me. Give you every reason to never believe in, and that's how I know you my destiny. No, I be tripping, yeah. Sometimes I know I'm a jerkin'. We've been through hell, you've been hurting. Just let me know it ain't working. Whenever I'm stepping out of line, failed you so many times. No matter what I do, I know that you gon' come through on time.
Life move fast, kinda blurry. No, it's all good, don't worry. I get you on the line.